bottoms of my shoes are clean from walking in the rain.
Once dismissed as cultural ephemera, the San Francisco beat poets now speak to a country whose entire democratic structure is threatened. America is becoming the exaggerated self-parody which the beat poets used as a rhetorical device, an enormous sick joke. Noam Chomsky, not given to hyperbole, calls the Republican Party the most dangerous organization in the history of the human race. Tory Britain, eager to become a vassal of America's joker-in-chief, is racing in its footsteps. It was this sense of an ominous and escalating deja vu that sent me back to the beat poets and to the talk that I gave at English and Scottish art colleges half a century ago. This is how the American Embassy used to look before the barricades went up. During the summer of 1966, I helped with our Festival of American Arts and Humanities. I could stroll in at any hour of the day or night, waving to the Marine guards, all of whom I knew by sight or even by name. I had a key to the Cultural Affairs storage room and often carried sound equipment away to work at home. No sign out, I could have emptied the room of everything portable. I was also on the embassy's list of available speakers on U.S. cultural topics. One day, Elizabeth Singleton in the Cultural Affairs office phoned me and asked if I could give a talk at an art college on the San Francisco beat poets. I said I'd love to do it like a radio documentary, with recorded examples and linking commentary, not so much a lecture, more of a presentation. But, alas, I no longer had the tapes. Let me introduce you to Eric Mottram, she replied. I read American Lit with him at King's. He has lots of recordings. He's always helpful. Come around to the embassy for lunch, and I'll introduce you. Lunch stretched to a three-hour conversation in which he offered exactly the tapes that I had wanted, including some that had been recorded at KPFA, stuff I'd long been familiar with. My other source was D.G. Brightson, the great BBC radio producer who made the third program one of the cultural marvels of the 60s. Jeffrey gave me typescripts of several of the programs in his remarkable radio series, America Since the Bomb, and most importantly, a tape copy of an interview that he had recorded with Kenneth Rexroth. You'll hear much of that later. The result was a lecture presentation with recorded inserts. The talk, just as I gave it, is once again contemporary, and so I've left it mostly as it was half a century ago. The big difference is that with PowerPoint, I've been able to add 150 images. They were mostly black and white, so I monochromed them all. The beats weren't colorful like the hippies. In those days, Allen Ginsberg was clean-shaven and often wore a sober tie and jacket. So, this country and western song by the Buchanan brothers sets the scene.
This world is at a tremble with his strength and mighty power. They're sending up to heaven to get the brimstone fire. Take warning, my dear brother, be careful how you plan. You're working with the power of God's own holy hand. Atomic power, atomic power, was given by the mighty hand of God. Atomic power, atomic power, it was given by the mighty hand of God. Remember two great cities in a distant foreign land. when scorched from the face of earth, the power of Japan. Be careful, my dear brother, don't take away the joy, but use it for the good of man and never to destroy. Atomic power, atomic power, was given by the mighty hand of God. Atomic power, atomic power, it was given by the mighty hand of God. Hiroshima, Nagasaki paid a big price for their sin. When scorched from the face of earth, their battle could not win. But on that day of judgment, when comes a greater power, we will not know the minute, and we'll not know the hour. Atomic power, atomic power, was given by the mighty hand of God. Atomic power, atomic power,
were they serious? The Buchanan brothers also laid down a track about God and flying saucers, but who cared? It was a top 10 hit in 1946. The bomb was an ever-present threat to our collective survival. In opposition to everything it stood for the most part, private, disorganized, and frightened. On the surface, the country seemed ready to rely on it as a diabolus ex machina on the side of truth, justice, and the American way of life. When President Eisenhower revealed how quickly the American stockpile of atomic weapons was growing, his words sounded like a boast, but they conveyed an ominous warning, and Ike knew it.
Atomic bombs today are more than 25 times as powerful as the weapons with which the atomic age dawned, while hydrogen weapons are in the ranges of millions of tons of TNT equivalent. Today, the United States stockpile of atomic weapons, which of course increases daily, exceeds by many times the total equivalent of the total of all bombs and all shells that came from every plane and every gun in every theater of war in all of the years of World War II.
This apparent faith in America's divine omnipotence went hand in hand with a naive conception of the international communist conspiracy. Within the context of what would come later, this statement by Secretary of State John Foster Dulles is highly ironic.
By the test of conception, birth, nurture, and obedience, the Mao Zedong regime is a creature of the Moscow Politburo, and it is on behalf of Moscow, not on behalf of China, that it is seeking to destroy the friendship of the Chinese people toward the American people.
Absolute faith in America's preeminence led to such arrogance as that expressed by Senator McCarran, co-author of the highly restrictive McCarran-Walter Immigration Act.
We should immediately sever diplomatic relations with the gang of international outlaws which pose as the government of Soviet Russia and her satellites. This is not a step toward war, but is a last hope to drive a wedge between an unholy band of mad marauders and one-third of the people of the world who are under their domination.
One of the most implacable opponents of communist China was Senator William Noland of California, spokesman for the Nationalist China Lobby and publisher of the powerful Oakland Tribune.
On the day that communist China is voted into membership in the United Nations, I shall resign my majority leadership in the Senate so that without embarrassment to any of my colleagues or to the administration, I can devote my full efforts in the Senate and throughout the country to terminate United States membership in that organization and our financial support of it.
By this time, Senator Joseph McCarthy's reputation had been destroyed during the Army-McCarthy hearings, but his activities and those of his imitators had left the intellectual community divided, discredited, and exhausted. The John Birch Society had driven some of America's greatest intellects and talents abroad, and of those remaining, too many had given McCarthy their support or remained silent. As for those who had opposed him, many were left with only the shattered remnants of their ruined careers. The thunderous acclaim which he had received at the 1952 Republican National Convention was still fresh in the national memory.
Ladies and gentlemen, is there anyone in this hall tonight? Is there anyone in our radio or television audience who can tell you why the President and the Secretary of Defense, why they say it's a crime not to betray this nation, but a crime to expose those who are betraying this nation? And I'd like to call upon those millions of Democrats today to scrub and flush and wash clean this government by voting the Republican ticket this fall. In this fight, some of my good friends have accused me of being too rough. To them I say, there is a common sense limit to gentleness and delicacy. That limit is where disloyalty and treason begin, where organized deceit and godlessness begin. If we are to win this fight, my good friend, if we are to win this fight, we must use all of the intelligence, all of the courage, all of the skill, every effort of mind and body. And if, as is obviously the case, a rough fight is the only fight the communists can understand, then the Republican Party will give them a rough fight. Even though it might be less unpleasant to do it another way, we can't fight communists in the Atchison-Lattimore fashion of hitting them with perfumed silk handkerchiefs at the front door while they batter our friends with brass knuckles and blackjacks at the back door. It can't be done that way. And I say, my good friends, I say that one communist in the defense plant is one communist too many. One communist on the faculty of one university is one communist too many. One communist among the American advisors at Yalta was one communist too many. And even if there are only one communist in the State Department, that would still be one communist too many.
That hysterical giggling behind the cheering was the senator's primitive equivalent to Mark Antony's "Mischief thou art afoot, take thou what course thou wilt." Intimidated intellectuals called it the age of conformity. And post-war youth, unheard from as yet, were uneasily labeled the silent generation. Professors had the feeling that their lectures were being taken down with the cynical footnote, "No comment." But here and there, rumbles were beginning to be heard, and one of the loudest and the most eloquent spokesmen, suddenly springing into prominence before receptive San Francisco audiences, was Allen Ginsberg. The silent generation had recovered its voice.
America, I've given you all, and now I'm nothing. America, $2.27, January 17th, 1956. I can't stand my own mind. America, when will we end the human war? Go fuck yourself with your atom bomb. I don't feel good, don't bother me. I won't write my poem till I'm in my right mind. America, when will you be angelic? When will you take off your clothes? When will you look at yourself through the grave? When will you be worthy of your million Trotskyites? America, why are your libraries full of tears? America, when will you send your eggs to India? I'm sick of your insane demands. When can I go into the supermarket and buy what I need with my good looks? America, after all, it is you and I who are perfect, not the next world. Your machinery is too much for me. You made me want to be a saint. There must be some other way to settle this argument. Burroughs is in Tangiers. I don't think he'll come back. It's sinister. Are you being sinister, or is this some form of practical joke? I'm trying to come to the point. I refuse to give up my obsession. America, stop pushing. I know what I'm doing. America, the plum blossoms are falling. I haven't read the newspapers for months. Every day somebody goes on trial for murder. America, I feel sentimental about the Wobblies. America, I used to be a communist when I was a kid. I'm not sorry. I smoke marijuana every chance I get. I sit in my house for days on end and stare at the roses in the closet. Whenever I go to Chinatown, I get drunk and never get laid. My mind is made up. There's going to be trouble. You should have seen me reading Marx. I have mystical visions and cosmic vibrations. America, I still haven't told you what you did to Uncle Max after he came over from Russia. I'm addressing you. Are you going to let your emotional life be run by Time magazine? I'm obsessed by Time magazine. I read it every week. Its cover stares at me every time I slink past the corner candy store. I read it in the basement of the Berkeley Public Library. It's always telling me about responsibility. Businessmen are serious. Movie producers are serious. Everybody's serious but me. It occurs to me that I am America. I'm talking to myself again. Asia is rising against me. I haven't got a Chinaman's chance. I'd better consider my national resources. My national resources consist of two joints of marijuana, millions of genitals, an unpublishable private literature that goes 1,400 MPH, and 25,000 mental institutions. I say nothing about my prisons, nor the millions of underprivileged who live in my flower pots under the light of 500 suns. I have already abolished the whorehouses of France. Tangiers are the next to go. My ambition is to be president, despite the fact that I'm a Catholic. America, how can I write a holy litany in your silly mood? I will continue, like Henry Ford. My strophes are as individual as his automobiles. More so, they're all different sexes. America, I will sell you strophes, 2,500 apiece, 500 down on your old strophe. America, free Tom Mooney. America, save the Spanish loyalists. America, Sacco and Vanzetti must not die. I am the Scottsboro Boys. America, when I was 7, Mama took me to communist cell meetings. They sold us garbanzos, a handful per ticket. A ticket cost a nickel and the speeches were free. Everybody was angelic and sentimental about the workers. It was all so sincere, you have no idea what a good thing the party was. In 1835, Scott Nearing was a grand old man, a real mensch. Mother Bloor made me cry. I once saw Israel Amter plane. Everybody must have been a spy. America, you don't really want to go to war. America, it's them bad Russians. Them Russians, and them Chinamen, and them Russians. The Russia wants to eat us alive. The Russia's power mad. She wants to take our cars from out our garages. Her wants to grab Chicago. Her needs Red Readers' digests. Her wants our auto plants in Siberia. Him big bureaucracy running our filling stations. That no good. Ugh, him make Indians learn read. Him need big black niggers. Ah. Her make us all work 16 hours a day. Help. America, this is quite serious. America, this is the impression I get from looking in the television set. America, is this correct? I'd better get right down to the job. It's true, I don't want to join the army or turn lathes and precision parts factories. I'm nearsighted and psychopathic anyway. America, I'm putting my queer shoulder to the wheel.
Let's come down to the present for a moment. What Ellen saw was a country which, from the top down, from the bottom up, was living a lie. Sound familiar? Ellen had stripped away the emperor's imaginary clothing. The next few minutes are not from my original talk, but from my KPFA website. It consists of a couple of short tapes which I would have used back then, if I had had them. Allen Ginsberg wrote much of his most famous poem, Howl, in my favorite Berkeley hangout, the coffee shop and bookstore, Il Piccolo, later renamed the Café Mediterranean. Howl was intended for performance, which it received on October 7, 1955, as part of the history-making reading at the Sixth Gallery in San Francisco. Later, Allen expanded it and added several more poems for publication by Lawrence Ferlinghetti's press, City Lights. KPFA station manager Lewis Hill explains in his introduction that the KPFA recording was broadcast several months before Ferlinghetti's arrest for publishing and selling an obscene book, which makes it one of the earliest recordings. After Lew Hill, you'll hear the first few minutes of the poem itself.
The recording of Allen Ginsberg's poem Howl, which you're about to hear, was made at KPFA several months ago, before the censorship controversy about the poem had arisen. This recording was, in fact, broadcast by KPFA some months ago, very late one evening. For those who are especially curious about the details of the obscenity issue surrounding this poem, it should be mentioned that Mr. Ginsberg's reading, if compared with the printed text of the poem, which led to the arrest and censorship trial we'll be discussing later on, reveals that the poet himself deleted for radio broadcasting one or two passages which appear in the book, Howl and Other Poems. Moreover, for this particular broadcast, and specifically in consideration of the hour at which this broadcast occurs, KPFA has edited out two or three words or brief passages in the poem, simply as a matter of taste. I think you may feel assured, however, in what you're going to hear, that the full essence of what has provoked the San Francisco Police Department into the arrest of Mr. Ferlinghetti is still present. Mr. Ginsberg's poem is addressed to a friend of his who is confined in an insane asylum in the East. The book, which Mr. Ferlinghetti was arrested for selling, has an introduction by one of the principal American poets of the 20th century, William Carlos Williams. Here are the last two paragraphs of Mr. Williams's introduction. He says, "It is the poet, Allen Ginsberg, who has gone in his own body through the horrifying experiences described from life in these pages. The wonder of the thing is not that he has survived, but that he, from the very depths, has found a fellow whom he can love, a love he celebrates without looking aside in these poems. Say what you will, he proves to us, in spite of the most debasing experiences that life can offer a man, the spirit of love survives to ennoble our lives if we have the wit and the courage and the faith and the art to persist. It is the belief in the art of poetry," Mr. Williams continues, "that has gone hand in hand with this man into his Golgotha, from that charnel house similar in every way to that of the Jews of the past war. But this is our own country, our own fondest purlieus. We are blind and live our blind lives out in blindness. Poets are damned, but they are not blind. They see with the eyes of the angels. This poet sees through and all around the horrors he partakes of in the very intimate details of his poem. He avoids nothing, but experiences it to the hilt. He contains it, claims it as his own, and, we believe, laughs at it, and has the time and effrontery to love a fellow of his choice and record that love in a well-made poem. Hold back the edges of your gowns, ladies. We are going through hell. Signed, William Carlos Williams." And now here is Allen Ginsberg reading the poem, How.
"I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked, dragging themselves through the Negro streets at dawn looking for an angry fix. Angel-headed hipsters, burning for the ancient, shuddering connection to the starry dynamo in the machinery of night, who poverty and tatters and hollow-eyed and high sat up smoking in the supernatural darkness of cold water flats floating across the tops of cities contemplating jazz, who bared their brains to heaven under the L and saw Mohammedan angels staggering on tenement roofs illuminated, who passed through universities with radiant, cool eyes hallucinating Arkansas and Blake Light tragedy among the scholars of war, who were expelled from the academies for crazy and publishing obscene odes on the windows of their skull.
The trial involved several KPFA regulars, including Al Bendick as defense lawyer and Kenneth Rexroth as a defense witness. Several years later, when Rexroth was identified by Time magazine as the father of the Beats, his response was, "An entomologist is not a bug." A supermarket in California was also recorded at KPFA in 1955, a year before it was published. It was set in the U-Save, a starkly modernist all-night Berkeley supermarket, which was my local grocery store of last resort. I may well have encountered Alan as I was picking up a midnight pint of milk, but I was too prosaic and too straight to share his erotic visions of Whitman and Lorca.
Okay, I'm going to read one that I did here in dear old Berkeley called A Supermarket in California, it being the supermarket down on Honor By Grove and University. On a rainy, lonely night. Of course, I wrote this after I had written a lot of great poetry, so that this is sort of like coming down off of the post-coitus priest, so to speak. What thoughts I have of you tonight, Walt Whitman, for I walk down the side streets under the trees with a headache, self-conscious, looking at the full moon. In my hungry fatigue and shopping for images, I went into the neon fruit supermarket, dreaming of your enumeration. What peaches and what penumbras, whole family shopping at night, aisles full of husbands, wives in the avocados, babies in the tomatoes, and you, Garcia Lorca, what were you doing down by the watermelon? I saw you, Walt Whitman, childless, lonely old grubber, poking among the meats in the refrigerator and eyeing the grocery boy. I heard you asking questions of each. Who killed the pork chops? What price bananas? Are you my angel? I wandered in and out of the brilliant stacks of cans, following you and followed in my imagination by the store detective. We strode down the open corridors together in our solitary fancy, tasting artichokes, possessing every frozen delicacy and never passing the cashier. Which way are we going, Walt Whitman? The doors close in an hour. Which way does your beard point tonight? I touch your book and dream of our odyssey in the supermarket and feel absurd. Will we walk all night through solitary streets? The trees add shade to shade, lights out in the houses. We'll both be lonely. Will we stroll dreaming of the lost America of love past blue automobiles and driveways, home to our silent cottage? Ah, dear father, graybeard, lonely old courage teacher, what America did you have when Charon quit poling his ferry and you got out on a smoking bank and stood watching the boat disappear on the black waters of Lethe?
Now, back to my original talk. What was it about San Francisco that was to make it a focal point of rebellion? Kenneth Rexroth, a battle-scarred revolutionary poet and essayist with an international reputation, had long been a leader of the San Francisco Underground, also known as the San Francisco Renaissance. And so he was in an ideal position to give a contemporary answer. Thomas Parkinson was one of the few academic friends of the Beat poets. We often had him on KPFA, and he wrote about Rexroth as follows. The chief figure in this awakening was Kenneth Rexroth. He was interesting, well-informed, friendly to the young. The amount of labor and confusion that he saved younger people was immense. Beyond his work as a poet and critic, Rex Roth organized discussion groups at his home, chiefly on political subjects, though he conducted some literary seminars. In addition to various poets and ordinary people, the discussions were attended by many of the conscientious objectors who, after the war, migrated in large numbers to the Bay Area and had much to do with establishing the range of intellectual interest. For example, many of the founders of the famous listener-supported radio station KPFA were among the participants. Through the poetry readings in Berkeley and San Francisco, and when it began operation in 1949 over KPFA, a fairly large audience was created that accepted and took interest in poetry readings.
Well, I might point out that San Francisco is the only community in the United States, except New Orleans, which is now sort of a dreadful tourist trap, which was not settled by the overland spread of Puritanism. But contrary to the moving pictures that you've seen, it was not settled by covered wagons. You know, a numerical majority were not overland settlers, but were people who came by sea across the isthmus, or to a lesser degree around the Horn, and of course they went to a gold rush, so that they were rascals, and prostitutes, and free livers, and no goods generally. And then San Francisco area is one of the few regions in which Italians and Jews, who are, have been, at least in the past, minorities who did not enjoy total privileges of blonde Nordic Protestants, are more or less culturally in control of the community and constitute the old families, the aristocracy. Well, this makes an entirely different cultural picture, so that the receptacle was there in the first place, you see. I mean, I've lived in Genova and Barcelona and Marseille. I've lived in Aix for a couple of years, and in Naples and so on. And this is the last, except perhaps Athens, island and time of Mediterranean life. It is very much that way. Well, this is a very congenial environment for the non-Puritan writer.
As Tom Parkinson wrote, an important and largely forgotten influence on San Francisco's artistic and intellectual ambience was the conscientious objectors coming down on leave from Camp Angel, the civilian public service camp near Waltport, Oregon.
There was a considerable amount of rejection, not necessarily a conscientious objection, but rejection of the war spirit in San Francisco. Then also in the States, we had something that you didn't have precisely. We had work camps for conscientious objectors. Now, due to the fact that most of these boys were assigned to work in the forests or in the mountains of the West, a very large number of them were somewhere around San Francisco. So that when they had leaves comparable to the leaves of a soldier, they would come down to San Francisco. And what happened, of course, was exactly the same thing that happened with the GI who went to fight in the South Pacific. He saw the flesh pots of La Vie Mediterranee in the San Francisco area and came back. So that this created a kind of cultural climate in the San Francisco region, which was totally unlike that of the eastern seaboard, where literature was largely under a domination of penitent Trotskyites and followers of the Confederacy. Very often the same people managed to be both.
And finally, there was the local indigenous presence of Zen, the easygoing offshoot of Buddhism, which flourished in a city with a very large and influential Japanese population.
You see, in Northern California particularly, but all up and down the West Coast, Oriental religion is not exotic. I mean, off in the vineyards or sugar beet fields, you may find a Buddhist temple. and the young men's Buddhist Association basketball teams play in a basketball league in San Francisco or Los Angeles or Stockton or someplace else like that. And there's a large, particularly Japanese community that Chinese are less, both less conscious of their tradition and less assimilated to American life, at least they were. So that you have this bridge. Then the GIs who came back from Japan after the war included an appreciable number of intellectuals who learned Japanese, learned Chinese, and were deeply imbued with a genuine, rather than a dime store incense burner bijouterie, orientalism.
We can't talk about the San Francisco beach scene without saying a few words about North Beach, where it was centered. It was an old, colorful, disreputable area spreading downwards from Telegraph Hill and concentrated along a few blocks of Grant and Columbus Avenues. It included the International Settlement and the Barbary Coast, centers of vice and dubious entertainment which dated back 100-odd years to the Gold Rush, and which later housed and hoarded the sailors who provided the labor force for San Francisco's vigorous trade with the Orient. The practice of Shanghaiing drunken sailors got its name not from that distant city, but from Shanghai Kili, an infamous nautical slave trader of the 1880s and 90s. By the 1950s, North Beach had been overrun by successive waves of Chinese, Italians, and Russians, and had assumed a character not unlike that of London's Soho, including the gawking tourists. Like Soho, it had four characteristics which made it an ideal residue for artistic and literary ferment: low rents, low moral censorship, impermanence, and a negligible sense of nationality. Vesuvio was a favorite beat hangout. I loved it. It had a sign in front which read, "Booth for Lady Psychiatrists." I don't remember ever seeing it occupied. Lots of other things were going on in North Beach besides poetry. The beats who attended the poetry readings were also making the scene at the City Lights bookstore, run by Lawrence Fairland Getty. More about him later. And the Cellar, where the poetry and jazz experiment flourished. We'll hear a sample of that in a few minutes. The Sixth Gallery, which not only helped to launch abstract expressionism, but also was the scene of Ginsberg's first explosive public reading of Howell. There was the Black Hawk and the Jazz Workshop, where most of the greats of modern jazz were heard and dug before they made Time magazine and were thus assured of immortality. There was the Purple Onion and the Hungry Eye, both of them small, intimate, very hip nightclubs which started the folk song revival with Stan Wilson, Odetta, and the Kingston Trio. The Hungry Eye also launched some of America's best stand-up comics, including Phyllis Diller, Professor Irwin Corey, and Mort Saul, with whom I used to hang out at Robbie's in Berkeley before he made the big time. That's a whole evening in itself. And now for the writers themselves, the people and the poems by which the whole movement will ultimately be judged. I don't have time to talk about many of the poets who were part of the scene but who couldn't be called beat. I hate to leave them out because they comprise some of the best work to come out of the period. There was Brother Antoninus, O.P., a great and original Catholic poet who transmuted the metaphorical and musical riches of Gerard Manley Hopkins into authentic American idiom. Jack Spicer, from whom I took a poetry writing class at UC Berkeley. Robert Duncan, Philip Whalen, and Gary Snyder, whose mastery of Oriental poetry and philosophy both sharpened and vivified his perceptions of the northwestern mountain forests, where he spent several summers working as a timber scaler at Warm Springs. I was introduced to Gary by a mutual friend when we were both 22. He took me to his cottage in a Berkeley backyard. It was like a perfect miniature Japanese house in every detail, of furniture and decoration, even the cooking utensils. And this was before he'd even been to Japan. Gary is one of the few poets of that generation still alive. I had a nostalgic email exchange with him just a few days ago. All these writers are so individual, and their relationship to the beat movement so tangential, that they must be left for separate consideration. And so, during this very condensed presentation, I'm concentrating on four closely related writers: Allen Ginsberg, Jack Kerouac, Lawrence Ferlinghetti, and Gregory Corso. Ginsberg and Corso were the lion and the lamb of the beat movement, and they would have been perfectly happy for you to carry the analogy through to its biblical conclusion. They were also the authors, respectively, of its Songs of Experience and its Songs of Innocence. Corso remained an innocent in spite of, or perhaps because of, a truly horrendous childhood, which he vividly describes.
I did not know how to write a poem when I felt I wanted to be a poet. I was 13 years old, and I was alone in the world. No mother, and my father was at war. I was of the streets, and no school did I attend. To exist, I stole minor things, and to sleep, I slept on rooftops and subways of the city, the big wild city of New York during World War II in 1943. I went through a strange hell that year, and I guess it is just such hells that give birth to the poet. There swelled in me at the time some inexpressible joy and sorrow. I wanted to tell the whole world about it, but just didn't know how. If I would have remained on the streets, I might not have known how. I was taken from my ill-directed yet necessary existence and was sent to prison. What would seem to most as a great injustice, my being sent to prison in my 17th year, where I was the youngest, rather than a boys' reformatory, if such had to be, proved to be one of the greatest things that ever happened to me. In prison, I was not hampered with the undeveloped and oft-times silly consciousness of youth. In prison, I had to deal with men, all kinds of men, caught in a single fate. And with time, I had to deal with time, 3 years of it. In that time, I read many great books and spoke to many amazing minds, men who had spent years on death row and who were reprieved. One can never forget talking to such men. One such man told me, "Boy, don't you serve time, let time serve you." And so it had. Time, so often so cruel, was kind and beneficial to me, in a very strange place. When I left a young man, self-educated in man at his worst and at his best. For this reason, I am unable to say anything real bad about prison. I do not say prison is a good place, far from it. For the middle-aged and old, it is a breathing coffin. Any door locked against a man is a sad business. But I am me, and it is not my fashion to dislike a dislikable thing when that thing has, in its strange way, been beneficial to me. Sometimes hell is a good place, if it proves to one that because it exists, so must its opposite, heaven, exist. And what was that heaven? Poetry. I did not write poems about prison or prison men. I wrote about the world outside, because I was once again outside with the world. I was of the world, not of prison. In prison I but learned, I did not write. If one must climb a ladder to reach a height, and from that height see, then it were best to write about what you see, and not about how you climbed. Prison to me was such a ladder. A saving grace and a disturbing handicap it is, to speak from the top of your head, putting all trust in yourself as truth-sayer. I write from the top of my head, and to write so means to write honestly, but it also means to write clumsily. No poet likes to be clumsy, but I decided to heck with it, so long as it allows me speak the truth.
Next, Jack Kerouac. In the photo, he's with his inseparable companion, Neil Cassady. Jack's three most familiar novels, On the Road, The Subterraneans, and The Dharma Bums, have probably been read by more people in more languages than any other literary products of the Beat Generation. This is partly because more people read novels than read poetry, partly because he made fewer demands on his readers, and partly because he was a spokesman not just for the artists and the writers of his generation, but also for the hot rodders, the potheads, and the high school hipsters who thought that in order to revolt, you only had to be revolting. Kerouac became a self-appointed advertising director for the Beat Generation. He claimed to have invented the label, but it was first used in print by Clement Holmes in the New York Times Magazine and by Kenneth Rexroth in New World Writing. Kerouac was a one-man North Beach Chamber of Commerce, cranking out page after page of hot copy. His boast that he never changed a word after he had written it recalls Ben Jonson, who, on being told that Shakespeare never blotted a line, replied, "Would that he had blotted a thousand." At the time, I had the feeling that Kerouac was an affectionately tolerated mascot whose uncritical enthusiasm was frequently embarrassing to his peers. Rexroth summed him up somewhat dismissively.
"I will never forget the time Jack Kerouac came to see me. The first week he was in San Francisco. He's only lived there a matter of weeks in his life. And announced that he was a Zen Buddhist and sat on the floor alongside of a gallon of wine, which he carries around like a hip flask of Prohibition days, and announced that he was a Zen Buddhist. And after a little while, he discovered that there were some 10 people in the room, all of whom read at least one Oriental language, and most of whom read three, that is, Chinese, Japanese, and Sanskrit. And I think it might have upset him."
Parenthetically, I should add half a century later that both Rexroth and I were to be proven wrong about Kerouac's survivability, perhaps because so many of today's young are once again living lives devoid of purpose or security. To continue with my original text, Kerouac was capable of pure prose poetry, even if he wasn't always able to sustain it. In 1957, I heard Charles Laughton read an extended passage from On the Road in one of his public recitals, which were made up of his personal choices of the world's great narratives. Here is Kerouac reading an extraordinarily vivid and perceptive Skid Row sketch from his short story, Neil and the Three Stooges.
"Neil was supposed to be looking after his work. We just blasted a pint in the car as we drove down the hill into wild mid-market traffic and out Third past the Little Harlem, where 2.5 years ago we jumped with the wild tenor cats and Freddie and the rest. I dig the Little Harlem in rainy midnights coming home from work in the black slouch hat from the corner, the pale pretty pink neons, the modernistic front, the puddles so rosy glowing at the foot of the entrance, the long arrowing deserted Folsom Street, which, as I hadn't remembered in my back east reveries, run straight into the far lights of the Mission or Richmond or whatever district, all glitters in the indigo distance of the night, to make you think of trucks and long halls to Paso Robles, bleak Obispo or Monterey or Fresno in the mist of highways, the ones with an end which is water orients and the empurpled Golgothian panoplies of Pacific Bowl and Abyss, past the dingy bars with their incredible names, colored bars like Moonlight in Colorado, that's one actually in Fillmore, or Blue Midnight, or Pink Glass, and inside it's all wretched raw brown whiskey and mauve boilermakers. Past Mission Street earlier, too, before Folsom, with its corner conglomerate of bums, or sometimes lines of dragged winos so torpid that when pretty women pass, they don't even look, even when they're waiting in line to give blood for $4 at Cutter's, so they can cut off and buy wine and brandy for the Embarcadero night. And if they do look, it's accidental. And they seem to be too guilty to look at ordinary women, only steamboat Annies of pierfront bougies with knots in their sticks for calf muscles and haggless tooth marks in their purply gums.
Yes, that's right.
Bums of Mission and Howard that live in miserable flop hotels like the Skylark in Denver.
If Kerouac was the ad man of the Beat Generation, Lawrence Ferlinghetti was both its scholar and its court jester. Rex Roth noted his ability to bite the butt of the eternal Colonel Blimp with the quiet, penetrating tenacity of an unperturbed bulldog. As well as having been a poet of lasting power, Ferlinghetti will also be remembered as the Sylvia Beach of North Beach. Her bookshop and press, Shakespeare & Co., was the center of the Anglo-American literary culture and modernism in Paris, and she was the first publisher of James Joyce's Ulysses. Ferlinghetti was an astute business manager, a perceptive publisher, and the self-possessed and learned author of elusively satirical verse. It all must have been good for him. He's still alive at 98. Kenneth Rexroth knew him very well.
Ferlinghetti is a rather nice kind of fraud. I mean, he's a good friend of mine. I'm not putting him down. But in the first place, Ferlinghetti is not a beatnik. He is a social critic. He is of French and Jewish ancestry. His mother, I think, is a Montesanto. This is a Sephardic Jewish family who own an appreciable amount of the West Indies in all linguistic bailiwicks. I mean, the Danish, the French, the Spanish, the English West Indies. There's a Montesanto someplace. And Ferlinghetti is a French name of remote Italian ancestry. And there are a number of Italian names in France like this. Now, Ferlinghetti is actually a very French poet. I mean, his most obvious influences, of course, are Prévert and Canot.
Yeah.
And a little like Canot. I mean, I know Canot quite well. And he speaks for obscene orphan waves in the metro and so forth. But actually, Canot, of course, is an extremely successful gentleman of letters and a publisher and power in France. So that this is a kind of literary device. And in the same way, Ferlinghetti is an extremely well-educated man. He has a large number of degrees, one of which is a genuine doctorate from the Sorbonne, of the sort they only give to Frenchmen, and a very successful businessman, and a very simple and direct and a rather ingenuous person in many ways. But what he writes is, I suppose, kind of literary mask in a way, although it actually reflects him very much. And it's very similar to the poetry of Canot and Prévert, both of whom he has translated. And again, you see, here you have an influence unknown on the East Coast in the days in which Ferlinghetti was first coming up. I mean, the average poet in New York had never heard of either of these two men, and most of them haven't yet.
Autobiography, the poem you're about to hear, was written especially for oral presentation within the newly evolving techniques of combining poetry with jazz. Ferlinghetti describes the experiment thus: "It really developed along with the Siller sessions. My whole kick has been oral poetry. The poets today are talking to themselves. I have no other audience. The competition from the mass media is too much. And the poets don't write their poems with the idea of their being read aloud in mind when they write it. Poetry used to have an audience. Vigil Lindsay went around the country reciting poems for bread. That was his phrase. And Sandberg, when he was younger, went around with a guitar and had an audience. We're trying to capture an audience. The jazz comes in as part of the attempt to get the audience back. I make use of phrases that are floating around in people's minds from advertising or from some slogan, and I give them a little twist. I was always trying to write so that the poems could have a public surface, which anyone could get. But there's no reason it couldn't have another level, which only the instructed can get. You can have all kinds of allusions to Waiting for Godot or Joyce or Hamlet or anything else, as long as it has a public surface, too, which doesn't depend on this. Autobiography is rich in allusion and traces the course of an ironic cultural explorer, the offspring of Walt Whitman and T.S. Eliot's J. Alfred Prufrock. I was the man. I was there. I suffered. somewhat. I've tried to get together images to go with it which serve as much as possible as explanatory footnotes. This performance was recorded in the Cellar, San Francisco, in 1957.
Leading a quiet life in Mike's place every day, watching the champs of the dainty billiard parlor and the French pinball addicts. I am leading a quiet life on Lower East Broadway. I was an American. I am an American boy. I read the American Boy magazine and became a Boy Scout in the suburbs. I thought I was Tom Sawyer, catching crayfish in the Bronx River and imagining the Mississippi. I had a baseball mitt and an American Flyer bike. I delivered the Woman's Home Companion at 5 p.m. or the Harold Tribune at 5 a.m. I still can hear the paper thump on lost porches. I had an unhappy childhood. I saw Lindbergh land. I looked homeward and saw no angel. I got caught stealing pencils from the 5 and 10 cent store the same month I made Eagle Scout. I chopped trees for the CCC and sat on them. I landed in Normandy in a rowboat that turned over. I have seen the ignorant armies on the beach at Dover. I have seen Egyptian pilots in purple clouds, shopkeepers rolling up their blinds at midday, potato salad and dandelions at anarchist picnics. I am reading Lorna Doone and A Life of John Most, terror of the industrialist, a bomb on his desk at all times. I am leading a quiet life on Lower East Broadway. I have seen the garbage men parade in the Columbus Day Parade. I have not been out to the Cloisters in a long time, nor to the Tuileries, but I still keep thinking of going. I have seen the garbage men parade when it was snowing. I have eaten hot dogs in ballparks. I have heard the Gettysburg Address and the Ginsburg Address. I like it here and I won't go back where I came from. I too have ridden boxcars, boxcars, boxcars. I have been in Asia with Noah in the ark. I was in India when Rome was built. I have been in the manger with an ass. I have seen the eternal distributor from a white hill in South San Francisco and the laughing woman at Luna Park outside the fun house in a great rainstorm, still laughing. I am leading a quiet life outside of Mike's place every day, watching the world walk by in its curious shoes. I once started out to walk around the world, but ended up in Brooklyn. That bridge was too much for me. I have engaged in silence, exile, and cunning. I flew too near the sun, and my wax wings fell off. I am looking for my old man, whom I never knew. I am looking for the lost leader with whom I flew. Young men should be explorers. Home is where one starts from, but mother never told me there'd be scenes like this. Womb weary, I rest, I have traveled. I have seen Goof City. I have seen the mass mess. I have heard Kid Ory cry. I have heard a trombone preach. I have heard Debussy strained through a sheet. I have slept in 100 islands where books were trees. I have heard the birds that sound like bells. I have worn gray flannel trousers and walked upon the beach of hell. I have dwelt in 100 cities where trees were books. What subways, what taxis, what cafes, what women with blind breasts, limbs lost among skyscrapers. I I have seen the statues of heroes at Carrefours, Danton weeping at a metro entrance, Columbus in Barcelona, pointing westward up the Rambla toward the American Express. I have heard 100 housebroken Ezra Pounds. They should all be freed. It is long since I was a herdsman. I am leading a quiet life in Mike's place every day, reading the classified columns. I have read the Reader's Digest from cover to cover and noted the close identification of the United States and the Promised Land, where every coin is marked in God we trust, but the dollar bills do not have it, being gods unto themselves. I read the want ads daily, looking for a stone, a leaf, an unfound door. I hear America singing in the yellow pages. One could never tell, the soul has its rages. I read the papers every day and hear humanity amiss in the sad plethora of print. I see where Walden Pond has been drained to make an amusement park. I see they're making Melville eat his whale. I see another war is coming, but I won't be there to fight it. I have read the writing on the men's room wall. I helped Kilroy write it. I marched up Fifth Avenue but hurried back to the Casbah looking for my dog. I see a similarity between dogs and me. Dogs are the true observers, walking up and down the world through the Malloy country. I have walked down alleys too narrow for Chryslers. I have seen 100 horseless milk wagons in a vacant lot in Astoria. Ben Shaw never painted them, but they're there, askew in Astoria. I have heard the junk man's obligato. I have ridden superhighways and believed the billboard's promises. Slept in mailbox overnight cabins, crossed the Jersey flats and seen the cities of the plain. And wallowed in the wilds of Westchester with its roving bands of natives in station wagons. I have seen them. I am the man. I was there. I suffered somewhat. I am an American. I have a passport. I did not suffer in public. And I'm too young to die. I am a self-made man, and I have plans for the future. I am in line for a top job. I may be moving on to Detroit. I am only temporarily a tie salesman. I am a good Joe. I am an open book to my boss. I am a complete mystery to my closest friends. I am leading a quiet life in Mike's place every day, contemplating my navel. I am a part of the body's long madness. I have wandered in various nightwoods. I have heard the loud lament of the disconsolate chimera. I am the man. I was there. I suffered somewhat. I have leaned in drunken doorways. I have written wild stories without punctuation. I have sat in an uneasy chair. I have heard the tolling bell. I am a tear of the sun. I am a hill where poets run. I invented the alphabet after watching the flight of cranes who made letters with their legs. I am a lake upon a plain. I am a word in a tree. I am a hill of poetry. I am a raid on the inarticulate. I have made paraphrastic studies in worn-out poetical fashions, and my equipment is always deteriorating. I have dreamt that all my teeth fell out, but my tongue lived to tell the tale. For I am a still of poetry, I am a bank of song, I am a player piano in an abandoned casino, on a seaside esplanade, in a dense fog, still playing. I see a similarity between the laughing woman and myself. I have heard the sound of summer in the rain. I have seen girls on boardwalks have complicated sensations. I understand their hesitations. I am a gatherer of fruit. I have seen how kisses cause euphoria. I have risked enchantment. I have seen the Virgin in an apple tree at Chartres and St. Joan Verne at the Bella Union. I have seen giraffes in jungle gyms, their necks like love wound around the iron circumstances of the world. I have seen the Venus Aphrodite armless in her drafty corridor. I have heard a siren sing at 15th Avenue. I have seen the white goddess dancing in the Rue des Beaux-Arts on the 14th of July, and the beautiful dame without mercy picking her nose in Chumley's. She did not speak English. She had yellow hair and a hoarse voice, and no bird sang. I am leading a quiet life in Mike's place every day, watching the pocket pool players, making the minestrone scene, wolfing the macaronis. And I have read somewhere the meaning of existence, yet have forgotten just exactly where. But I am the man, and I'll be there. And I may cause the lips of those who are asleep to speak, and I may make my notebooks into sheaves of grass, and I may write my own eponymous epitaph, instructing the horsemen to pass.